Right, so our speaker today is Forward Miser Quadro, who's an old friend and colleague of mine who, when he came to Britain some years ago, was employed by the Refugees, Asylum Seekers and the Media Project as a coordinator, and went on to lead the Exile Journalist Network that was set up, which provided support for some 200 exile journalists in Britain. But he moved on from there to lead a movement called the City of Sanctuary here in Bristol, and by galvanising support from the local community and the business community and the local authority, Bristol was declared a City of Sanctuary, and Forward then went on and is now the national coordinator for the City of Sanctuary movement. So he's come quite a long way from his early days as a journalist in Zimbabwe. Now, I don't know how much you know about Zimbabwe, once known as Rhodesia. And when it was known as Rhodesia, there were a lot of people, especially young men, who were involved in the liberation struggle there and who had to get out of the country. And one of them used to stay with me way back in the 70s, a guy called Chenjid Mengwende. And when ZANU-PF won their battle against Ian Smith and his ilk, he went back. I was always quite pleased to have had this relationship with this guy, until his name cropped up in stories about repression of journalists, because he'd become a press officer for the government, the Minister of Information. Was he a Minister of Information?
Yeah.
And he was locking up journalists. And suddenly I didn't really want to admit to this knowledge. I'm told that he was one of the better repressors, because he gave up and was given a farm and is now living happily in the countryside. But for many journalists there, it was not a happy time, having thought that they were winning the battle for independence. And Ford is one of those journalists who had eventually to escape from independent Zimbabwe. So I'll pass you over and he can tell his story.
Afternoon, everybody. Thanks, Mike, for the introduction. Probably I'll start by saying, Forward, how did I become into journalism? After my A-levels, I always wanted to be a lawyer. That was my, you know, my focus. I wanted to be a solicitor. When I finished my A-levels, then we used to have only one university in the country. That was the University of Zimbabwe. So you can imagine competition was so stiff. It was very, very, very difficult. You could only, for you to do law, you need to have at least 13 points. And unfortunately, I had 10 points. So I was disappointed, but probably my disappointment was lack of maybe understanding and wisdom. I ended up doing, studying journalism. By then, it was so exciting because I was lucky enough. I worked in the private media. In Zimbabwe, we have, state media and private media. It was sort of thriving then. It was so small and very, very powerful. We have a very small, media compared to here. And we were enjoying during that time because we could also, go to press and say, monthly press briefings. If I leave a message to say, Minister so-and-so, the Chen Chimtengwendes that you are talking about, that I've left a message, he would respond because they knew that obviously if you have received a call from the private media, there's probably a juicy story that is going on. So we were really, excited. It was so powerful. Then comes about 1999, that's where things sort of started, going down. From, what Mike had said, since independence in 1980, Zimbabwe had only the opportunity of having one leader, Comrade Robert Mugabe, since 1980 to the present day. So you can imagine, I'm not very good in mathematics, but you guys probably are better. If you calculate from 1980 to today, how many years we have one president. But there is a lot that we can talk about Mugabe legacy. But one thing that he has done, if I digress a bit, it's about the affording the opportunity in terms of education. He did very well in terms of opening up for some of us to get access to education. But to flash a bit forward, since the discussion today is about my experience working in Zimbabwe and where we are today. It's sort of, you know, if you're looking at it now, it was an exciting challenge. Exciting in the sense that, you create your name. It was very easy to create your name in the media industry in Zimbabwe then. But however, when things started to, turn down in terms of economically, and also the mushrooming or the coming up of, opposition politics in this sense, the one main vibrant, opposition part called the Movement for Democratic Change, which was set up in 1999. And we sort of also shifted in terms of our reporting. We were also going down into rural places where probably some of the people were starting to see their images in the media rather than have not even seen their photo in their lives. So we're talking about human stories that really affected people. And also at the same time, the opposition, those were involved in the active sort of politics, there was this sort of really realization that there is a crisis of governance. And what the government did then, immediately they stopped inviting the private media to press conference. That was the first thing that we experienced. We're no longer invited. We were no longer invited to any, government or, ministers' press briefings. But we, you have to, go through different, unorthodox means of getting information, because, that's why, we have, as journalists, we have to dig out stories. And we were getting loads of information of what is happening in the, corridors of power. And it didn't go out well with the government, and including also the international media that was also stationed in Zimbabwe. There was Reuters, there was BBC, all the main media houses that you can think of were really in Zimbabwe. But the story that really shifted the platform was the way how the land reform in our country has been sort of done. There is a crying need for land reform in Zimbabwe. There is no doubt about it. But I think the manner at which the government embarked on redistributing land, that was where the problem is. I remember I traveled extensively in my country from south, west, north to east, and witnessing how the chaotic manner at which people were being parceled or given pieces of land because they were, supporting the Mugabe regime. And obviously, some of us, I remember I was moonlighting for the Sunday Times then, which, at the end of the day didn't, work out well for me, because, I'm now standing here. But let's park that. In terms of, the paper that I was working for, it was a weekly paper. We published it on a Friday. Then we also had another sister paper, which we're talking about, Cornelius was working with, published on a Sunday. Then we had another daily news. And I was working on that weekly that was published on a Friday. I remember very well that when the newspaper is published on a Friday, you will find it's only, administrators, chief executive, who will be in the office. But most of us will not be in the office. You want to check who is actually the reception for that, because all of us will be worried to see. Because what happens is, if after the newspaper comes out, if there's a story, the next thing that you know, you see police officers will be at your newsroom. And coincidentally, our offices, and where it is still right now, we're adjacent to the very main building of the ZANU-PF, building. You have some of the people that have been visiting Zimbabwe probably know. And what will happen is, the police and order, it will be a Friday. So they will come in the morning before everybody arrives, and they will be picked on a Friday. And you can imagine, that's a very good weekend. They know that you spend the whole weekend in prison. Then if you're lucky enough, you're out on Monday. That is if you're lucky. If you're lucky to come out on Monday, walking yourself without any, that's, we thank God. But some of us, you could imagine, the physical injustice that would be done on your body. So those are some of the, things that you, experience. And they started to, in order to survive, you started to practice self-censorship. You started to sort of, you know, self-censor yourself, because at the end of the day, you started to imagine whether should I sacrifice my life by reporting what is happening, or... But I have to admit, there were very brave people that continues to report about it. And also, we had very, very competent solicitors and lawyers. But what has happened then, it includes those solicitors as well, were also on the receiving end. They've been, you know, arrested. I remember one of our directors was called Beatrice Mutetwa, and she's still there. Very, very, very courageous, very, very strong, very competent solicitor. Always she's there, but she has been, you know, all day long she has been to any prison that you've been, you know, you can talk of in Zimbabwe, but survive. So they will also, you know, end up being arrested with you. In terms of the state media, in as much as they were not going to receive sort of physical violence, etc., but the reporting is no longer about what is happening. The story is a diluted story. It's about, it's not about what is happening in the country. So which means people are now being misinformed about what is happening. That's the disadvantage of, you know, working that kind of sort of an environment. But it also helps you to be creative from the, you know, hardships. You become very, you know, creative in terms of, you know, online, in terms of how can you, you know, overcome, how can you work in such an, you know, environment that you end up sort of, you know, surviving. But at the same time, it also had an impact on our advertisers, because they are no longer feel comfortable to advertise in your newspaper. So it means the industry is affected. With, you know, and with my also, you know, ambition, I'm very, very, you know, active within my student union. I thought one of the ways, maybe through our Zimbabwean Union of Journalists, we can also champion and, you know, some of the issues that we face as journalists. But I didn't realize that actually by, you know, going into, you know, union as well, it was also, you know, adding, you know, paraffin to already, you know, burning light. It was, you know, very easy, but We you know, grouped ourselves and said, you know, what are some of the things that we can do in order to, you know, survive. One key issue that they have for everybody to practice in Zimbabwe, whether in the private, independent, freelance, anybody, you have to go through the Ministry of Information. We had to go through Chen Chimtengwende's office. Whether, an example is, if you're working for the Guardian, everybody has to go through that ministry. If you don't have that card from the ministry, you are no longer supposed to practice as a journalist. That's it. So you have to produce your documents. One, evidence that you are working for this particular newspaper. So you have to confirm your address. It looked as if when they started, it looked genuine. But actually, we were selling ourselves. You have to provide your, you know, where you live, your next of kin. So which means my wife, my mom, my dad. So if anything happens, the next thing you know, they're at your house. They're at my mom's house. They're at your, you know, everywhere. Because we had thought genuinely you have to be accredited with the ministry. But actually, this, you know, they would sort of share with the, you know, the police, and particularly with the central intelligence people. And when you produce your, you know, your ID, you have your ID from your, you know, your newspaper. But the key was, we need to have that ID from the Ministry of Information. When they, you know, realized that actually the physical, you know, abuse of people has gone to the extreme, because of also, you know, the, in some of the, unfortunately, you know, the media houses have been chucked out of, you know, of Zimbabwe, the BBCs and etc. But the story has been sort of on the international media for quite some time. They had now cleverly sort of said, let's come up with laws so that it looks as if it's fine. If there's this law, then we will easily take you to court. So they come up with the very, very, you know, repressive laws. It's a pity that that law was actually crafted by a very competent professor who was all along, he was based in South Africa, came back to, he was actually a columnist in my newspaper. Which was so funny. He was very critic, very, you know, very, 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 and, you know, very competent professor, but he's the one who enacted that AIPA, which is called Access to Information and Privacy Act, which makes that, you know, legally there were now boundaries on how people, you know, operate. And I, you know, remember my last time in Zimbabwe. That was in 2002. I was with a colleague of mine, is now the late, from the Sunday Times. We just wanted to, you know, look at, they had invaded a farm near Harare, which is about a mile, about 20 miles from the main capital city of Zimbabwe. And I just get off the car and I was walking. I see quite, you know, very young people who were mobilizing people, you know, mobilizing people that, oh, they've taken up this farm. And little did I know that I didn't know that actually the people that were behind, because when I just parked the car and walked, I was, you know, apprehended. And luckily, here's a guy, is the first time in Zimbabwe from UK. At least his legs managed to, you know, carry him away, and he drove, he went. And I was left. That's when I realized that actually it was all engineered, because when I was put, they was put into a bush, and they were, it was actually the army officers who were responsible for the chaotic scenes in the farms. And, you know, all my stuff was done. And when they saw that, you know, it's very fairly easy, they knew me. But, you know, thank God, this guy, when he left, he went to the police officer. As you can imagine, somebody from UK, he thought the police officer can do something to help. It makes sense that somebody has been abducted. So the next thing you do is to go to the police officer. So he went to the police station. It's the main police center in the city center. He was shouting, oh, there's a colleague of mine has been arrested. And nobody responded to him. So the person was at the desk. He said, okay, who? He said, forward has been arrested, has been, you know, detained. So he said, okay, hold on. He just went. That was it. So he was left on his own at the reception. But, you know, because he was so frustrated and thought, he started banging and sort of shouting, well, this is, you know, is there somebody who can help me here? And mentioning forward. Forward is a very, very unusual name in Zimbabwe. And for those people probably who know, somebody had that forward. So he thought, there's only forward that I know. So we're together at uni. So he came and said, what happened? And he said, oh, my colleague has been arrested. But, you know, that was some of the, he was very, very brave. He said, okay, that's fine. You go back to your hotel. I'm going to arrest. So he took the police car and he came. You know, I was really severely, you know, beaten and, you know, other stuff. So he came and said, oh, I'm from the, you know, with his uniform and his car, and said, okay, I'm arresting. So he arrested me, but actually he was taking me to the hospital. Thus they were sort of, you know, to the union. The next day, you know, I'm with Mark Jameson and colleagues and here in UK. So I was just sort of, those are some of the, you know, the things that sort of, you know, happened. But I think when you're sort of reflecting and look at it now, you thought, but there is also, you know, the excitement that and the motivation that you have to continue doing it for the betterment of the country, because people need to hear all those stories. People, if you leave it, people will not, what's going to happen? You have to keep on sort of soldiering on. So I don't want to sort of talk much. I just wanted to sort of, you know, to open up. And some of the things that, you know, there are colleagues that you have sort of worked with, some of them, like, you know, Beatrice Mteto, that you probably know. Yeah, you can sort of share your experience in 2003 when you were in Zimbabwe. By that time, I've left the country. And when I left, when I was here, the next thing that I had was my newspaper was bombed. And up to now, we don't know who bombed. But luckily, when I was sort of living in Bristol through the work that I'm doing, I managed to get hold of some of the, you know, the people that were within the Zimbabwean community. And one of the women, without disclosing the name, she was the secretary of the police commissioner. And she confided to me that actually the bomb came from that office. And up to today, there is nothing, that nobody had been arrested, but they know. So these are some of the things that are happening. Of late, you just receive an envelope with bullets in your, you know, the sort of tricks things to intimidate you. But I think the key disadvantage that he had, it killed the people, is self-censorship, really. And also the people that will, you know, tell you stories, you know, it's sort of really dumb. But it helped people to, you know, be very creative, particularly with, you know, online media now. There's nothing that they don't have the capacity. So there are other ways that you can also, you know, do rather than relying on the sort of the mainstream media. Probably I talked much about print. Broadcasting is nothing, because there was no private media at all. After the BBC had left and other, you know, Al Jazeera's and stuff, there was completely nothing. It was only state media, Channing, you know, propaganda, really. Yeah, on that note, probably put a full...
I'm going to ask you a couple of questions first, if I may. Are you suggesting that what we get out of Zimbabwe now is not to be believed?
No, but I think probably I can rewind and say, particularly the British media, probably also I have to admit, including myself, they failed the Zimbabwe story. They failed in the sense that at times it's not, or I'm sort of not generalizing. I think the way how initially the story was reported, it was if it was a racial issue, a black versus white, because the sum of the story is really that you, yes, you had a particular audience that you were, you want as a British media, but I think they failed to report the actual, it was a crisis of governance. There was, it wasn't really whites versus black. And Mugabe actually used that because he now used that racial card. So it was later actually that people realized that they were promoting a wrong story. So I think the media there, to some extent, it failed.
But what, how do you explain that Mugabe, who's been there for 35 years, is now president of the Organization for African Unity? I mean, clearly is seen as a hero across Africa, and yet you're suggesting that he's a repressive monster.
As I said, he is a very, you know, smart, a clever politician. There's no doubt about it. But I think what is key is if you are leading a country with people who are poverty-stricken, with people who don't have electricity, with people who don't have clean water, I think you have to, common sense. If the ordinary Zimbabweans have food at their table, probably we could all sort of clap our hands that we have, a leader that had done. He did very well, you know, during the, you know, probably the first 5 years, where, again, he's not being, a lot of people don't talk about it. I think in terms of the reconciliation after, in 1980, after independence, he's the first person who said, let's live together. Yes, of course, Mandela came on the scene, but I think Mugabe did. But after that, for the first 5 years, probably, including all ourselves, probably we were all maybe in the euphoria of celebrating our political independence. But while he was engineering, so things got worse. And when you continue leading, probably you tend to, you know, just, you know, things are, there's nothing that's going to happen and just relax. And the level of, I think, you know, violence within, not only within the opposition, even now, within his own political party, there are lots of people. It's just probably, you know, unacceptable.
Has anyone got any questions for me?
Do you feel there'll be any change in the regime anytime soon? He's getting old now, isn't he?
I think that's the danger, that we're waiting for nature to take its course. That's what is, but I think it's hopeful. Particularly now, I think there is hope because of the way how his main political party is so disunity in his main, you know, the main key players are now out. So the message is now there's quite a lot of discord within the ZANU-PF government. So the chances are we can, you know, be hopeful. And also, secondly, as, you know, Mike had said, I think age and its own, I think he is now very tired. He's the only glue. If he disappears from the scene, everything will disintegrate. That's a fact. He's the only person that, you know, sort of, you know, bring people together within his, you know, political party. He will also leave, you know, a legacy that it's two legacies that some that is, you know, positive, but I think it has been overshadowed by a lot of negativity. I think it's that now worse things than the positive things, unfortunately.
Do you think it leads to chaos what he does?
Yes. Yeah. And we just hope that that chaos will not lead to bloodshed.
On a slightly lighter note, in his State of the Nation address, when he addressed Parliament recently, the opposition parties were threatening to boycott or to barrack his speech. And they were then threatened by ZANU-PF members, and they decided they would sit silently. And then Mugabe came in and read the wrong speech, which was very embarrassing because it was a speech that he'd read to Parliament before. And even his own supporters didn't quite know what to do. So the poor old soul has passed his prime.
But I think that example is a very good example that shows that I think there is now a crisis and confusion within his party, because you would expect that the press secretary would have read that statement before. So they are all playing all this so that he looks, you know, stupid publicly. We you know, in as much as he's odd, but surely within the system, they deliberately, you know, play. Someone is responsible for that for that speech.
Can I just ask, because as an interested party, because I was working for AP, we had a bureau in Zimbabwe, and Cornelius, who you mentioned earlier, was the AP sort of stringer there. Mm. Very, very difficult situation to work. Do you think, and as you said, most of the sort of Western media were kicked out. How do you think, you said earlier that there was a kind of racial dimension with a lot of coverage of the farm invasions, mm-hmm. white farms, or farms owned by white people being taken away from them and given to other people, mm-hmm. this distribution of land. But do you think since then, we haven't heard very much about Zimbabwe, mm-hmm. do you think that's because that dimension has kind of disappeared? How do you think that Zimbabwe is being served by the international media, I suppose, is what I was saying?
I think the challenge here comes in the fact that you don't no longer have those people on the ground. Yeah. That's one of the, you know, one of the difficulty, because we no longer have, you know, AFP, we don't no longer have even, you know, Reuters. The only sort of Reuters was the only that sort of survived. The only reason why they sort of survived is because of the guy who was the heading, you know, Reuters Africa, who really, you know, we had sort of lots of sort of, you know, political connections in Zimbabwe and sort of, you know, again playing the tune. I think that's one. Then secondly, I think it's, you know, other events has also overtaken, because some may be thinking Zimbabwe is a tired story. I think it's a question of looking at sort of, you know, new creative stories that can come out. But I think mainly is by lacking people on the ground, and they know that, you know, in as much as they would want to support, it's risky. You're risking people's lives, because a lot of, you know, guys end up, you know, in diaspora, wherever they are, or some, as we speak, there's another guy that is not been seen, as, you know, he was just disappeared. He was driving in the middle of the city center in a truck, having his hair cut, and he was taken. And for the past now nearly 100 days, nobody knows where he is. In, you know, daylight, somebody being kidnapped.
But it's interesting, I suppose, from an international point of view, it's very dangerous in the Middle East at the moment, but there are plenty of reporters there. Yeah. We have nobody in Zimbabwe, which are kind of great big gaps in the international coverage for that. You know, maybe it's an easy explanation, say, well, it's a bit dangerous and nobody wants to go there, but there's also that kind of agenda of what's important for the international news over there.
No.
Richard.
Mine's more of an observation than a question. And you painted a subtle picture that I think I can understand. I think there's a parallel in our history. I'm seeing Mugabe like Henry VIII. There were land grabs, there was the same repression, but there was a rule of law. It was all weighted in favour of the guy who governed. So I just see that. You know, it's not inconceivable. This is a world we've lived in not that long ago. You would agree that 500 years not that long ago. I can understand the world you're painting. It's not North Korea, which is, you know, a weird other world. This is a very human, understandable world. So it's not a question, but I'm just thanking you for that.
Thank you.
Are there people here from countries which have got similar problems or repressive regimes in terms of the press?
You know what I'm saying? There's not a lot to
say. I wouldn't say it's as bad as Zimbabwe, but in Malaysia, you know, the press is controlled to a certain degree. Mm. And like publications like newspapers, every year you have to apply for a new license. So if the government isn't happy with what you're presenting or publishing, you may have a little bit of a problem trying to get a new license. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so it's quite interesting otherwise to hear it from.
I think it's very interesting what you were saying about the registration, because there are a lot of people who've said, especially after all the things that came out during the Leveson inquiry, that we ought to have journalists registered so that if they misbehave, they can be struck off. But you can see how dangerous it is that not only why should anybody decide which of us can be journalists or not, but if you've got to be registered, you're putting a lot of other things at risk, as you say, you know, your family and everybody around you. So it's worth bearing that in mind when people start talking about registering journalists and the like. We should all be free to do this sort of a job if we want to, and not be beholden to the government. Was there another hand back there? Was that your hand I saw earlier on, Richard?
Somewhere over here.
Is that?
Yeah, I was going to ask, is there any way that we can get, you know, proper, accurate information coming out of Zimbabwe, or is it all, I don't know, coming through the government at this point?
There are actually, you know, that's what I'm saying. Recently also with the sort of fortunate, you know, internet age, there are quite a lot of online newspapers, publications, some, you know, based here. We actually have quite another called newzimbabwe.com is published from here. We have also a very physical newspaper. It's called The Zimbabwean. It's both online and in print. It's based, published in South Africa, but it's actually, the editor is based here. He was the editor of the Daily News with Mbanga. He'd been very seasoned journalist for quite a long time. And people quite, no, these days use really, you know, I think the mobile phone, there's so much use of the mobile phone, you know, from banking to everything in Zimbabwe, most of sort of the African country. So phone has become so, so important. You know, my grandma can even send you an image of what has happened. So unlike where we wait to read the newspaper, there are loads of sort of sources of information that are, you know, is coming in. And yeah, you know, the other, you know, press are still, you know, there. The Zimbabwe Independent newspaper is still there. They've also opened up because we had a unit of government before a couple of years ago. So it sort of changed. There's a sort of move to repeal some of these repressive laws. So there's now, I mean, 4 private newspapers that are still, you know, now publishing in Zimbabwe. There's a daily, two daily news, 2 weekly newspapers. So there are sort of sources of, you know, information available. But however, I think the quality, also the level of journalism has sort of a little bit go down, because most of the really, you know, seasoned, you know, the Cornelius Nduna that I'm talking about, lots of sort of the senior journalists have either really moved out of the profession completely, which means you only have very, you know, newly, with all due respect, on most of sort of the newly, you know, qualified, you know, people joining in, but they're joining in with all this sort of working, this, and it's not easy. So it really reduces sort of the quality of journalism, a little bit gone down.
Has state repression moved into the internet age as well? So is there censorship present online and or ramifications for posting sort of a picture live from a scene of an event or anything like that?
Yes, as we're speaking to now, 2 days ago, there's a guy who is actually is in court. He published a picture, just a funny picture of Mugabe. You know, just be creative, and you know, he is actually in court. It's unfortunate. Zimbabwe adopted what they call a look east policy, which they worked very well with China, and they have invested quite a lot in terms of looking specifically on internet through the army. I think that, but you know, that's where our relationship with China is a bit uncomfortable, particularly the, you know, general. They are, you know, looking into people. They are looking into news. There's a lot, but they can't compete because of lack of resources. But that relationship with China, that's exactly what they were wanted to do. They can only manage to control some of this, but they can't, because the major, you know, telecoms operator in Zimbabwe is a private guy who's based in South Africa. So they don't have the capacity, but they have attempted to do that. There's quite a long marathon court case that is currently going on, which they've lost after they spent quite a lot of money wanting to go to, you know, US on Facebook. There was a guy that was running exactly what is happening in cabinet every minute, every second, with really, really very, very, you know, solid data. And to their naivety, they appointed that guy to be one of the editor of the state newspaper. And they realized actually later that he was the one who was running this Facebook page. But they couldn't, you know, because of the because of the internet laws and stuff, they couldn't, you know, arrest. So they've, I think it's a challenge. I think that's one of the things that can, they can close newspapers, but I think online they would fail.
There's another question here.
Yeah, when Mugabe does die, what would you like to see like happen in the world of journalism and in Zimbabwe?
Probably I don't wish him to die, because what I would want to wish him to actually, I wanted to see him, people, you know, journalists practice, you know, very, in a very free, democratic way, expressing themselves, including him also being given the opportunity and being reported in a very fair and accurate way. You know, it's a pity, because if he die, he won't see the other side. But I hope that, you know, after his departure, we will, you know, they become sort of the country becomes normal, the rule of law is respected, and you know, also, you know, the quality of journalism is also increased, so that, you know, is also improved, and, you know, exercise, you know, press freedom and uphold it. It's there in our constitution, it's in, you know, on paper, but in practice, that's where I want to see it be, you know, implemented, because it's already there in our constitution anyway.
Can you still train to be a journalist at the university then in Harare?
Yes.
Right, okay. So he teaches that one.
Yes, they are. So that's where the problem is, because what they are doing, they're very clever. What they are now doing, because it's a very training, our university is small. So what they do is they recruit young people from the Central Intelligence. Those are the ones that are going to do journalism. So it's, yeah, they mix, you know, we have 30, let's say 30 students. Then, you know, from those 30, I can assure you another bunch is from the Central Intelligence. So if you have those Central Intelligence, they will go into your newsroom, whether it's state and whether it's private. So they, you know, infiltrate in the newsroom that way. But there are other also, you know, some who are, you know, going to be trained, you know, outside the country. They are private institutions. Some also, you know, newspapers have to do in-house as well. Yeah.
But don't the journalist unions do anything about this at all?
They do. They you know, they do quite, you know, a campaign. They do hold, you know, meetings. They, you know, liaise with that, with the region as well, with the MISA, Media Institute of Southern Africa, and other players. But they are also limited in what they can do, because it's the whole. You need a complete overhaul, really. Yeah. That's what's needed. You cannot only address the media alone. Yes, you can address media, but you need political will to support it.
Any more questions, Tom?
Just one quick question also about your personal development. You said earlier that, you know, press freedom is actually in the Constitution. Mm. So, when did you realize that it was only in the Constitution but not in reality? Was it something that you knew from an early age, or was it something where you, over a period of time, grew to be disappointed by how your country actually is?
Yes, as I mentioned earlier, I said when we were all excited because we can, you know, express ourselves. But what is, you know, what is happening later was, I think that your freedom after you express yourself, that is no longer, that's when you realize actually that it's not there, because they would say, okay, there's, you know, if you go today, they would say there's press freedom. But actually what happens after you unearth some of the ills within both private sector and government, it's what is the problem. Because if you're at the end, we are receiving end of physical torture, physical beating, or spend most of your time in courts, I find it very, you know, unhelpful. really. Unless, yes, I do, you know, respect as well. If we fail as journalists in terms of maybe we have inaccurate, I think that there are ways of how do we address it. You know, we have to, you know, make corrections. There are legal, you know, there are certain things that we have to follow. But it doesn't have to come from, probably from the government, really.
I do wonder that kind of realization of that disappointment in your country. Mm. I do wonder from being excited about it and then over a period of time that the gap between your initial perception and the reality you experienced opening up, that must have been very...
Yeah, it has been, you know, very, very tough because you feel the, you know, the anger. You also feel let down, let people down, actually, because people, they would also look as that's their only voice. Because, you know, it was fairly easy where you go, you talk to people who have been, you know, severely, you know, beaten, tortured, really people coming up and stories. But now you are no longer able to do it. You are now, you know, self-censoring yourself. At times, you know, if you are a photographer, I think, is it better for me to put this image? What will happen to this family? So, you are starting, you know, you feel guilty because there are certain things that you can't do. Because you are not sure of what, you know, the repercussions after publicity. So you feel, you know, you feel like you are sort of not really doing your role. It does, you know, pains quite a lot, actually. But yeah.
Are we done? Well, I'd like to thank you very much indeed for all this. Numerous local and national papers and by students here, so he's always available to be interviewed. And in fact, there's a piece in today's Guardian about the City of Sanctuary movement, which he set up, which you might like to read. And, you know, if you need to contact him, I'm sure he'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have. So, do you want to say anything about the City of Sanctuary movement quickly before people depart? Because most people here won't know.
All right, okay. City of Sanctuary is a concept that started in Sheffield in 2005. The whole idea is really to promote the idea of welcoming people, welcoming refugees. How do we, as you know, as a city, as you know, UK at large, we welcome people who have been, you know, uprooted in their countries of origin. We are now rebuilding their lives and career in the UK. And currently we have about 60 cities across UK and Ireland. We are very active within the movement. 40 of them are very, very active. There are processes that a city has to go through to in order to be accorded that status of being a city of sanctuary. But the key fundamental thing is just promoting the principle that, you know, how do you want people to be received? How do we collectively as a city, particularly here where, you know, my involvement in Bristol, how do we want to see people being welcomed? If we look with the, you know, current refugee crisis that have been going on, cities saying we are welcoming, you know, Syrian resettlement, how do you want them to be welcomed in our city? How do we play our role? So it's two ways, both who people were coming to live as well as those people who already live in the city. We have this long tradition anyway. And I will say, at times we look and said probably these things will pass. But then there's history that we need to remember, because you are also part of that history. If you look 20 years down the line and said probably we had failed the Syrian refugees, those young people that we've seen, you are also part of that history. When you're, you know, 20 years, 40 years down the line, whenever you look, probably because we talk about the World War II when these refugees were coming, they said these things happened. And we're also, you know, in the living memory. So these things might also haunt us 20 years or whatever years come by. Also, you know, within different careers and professions, I always say life is meandering. Probably one day you might be a stringer, you might be a doctor in Zimbabwe, you might be a doctor and come across and helping some of the people that have become, you know, victims of, or you might be a psychologist, you might be a counselor. So we have to think broadly when we talk about refugees. Don't think that, okay, because I don't know them, but because of your career path, you come across some of these things in different. So that's what we are promoting locally and nationally. On that note, I say thank you.
Thank you.
really admire her, has something to say.